Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Duel Without End, Mankind's Battle with Microbes, by Stig S. Frøland, translated by John Irons, narrated by Daniel Thomas May. Foreword. Throughout human history, a duel has been fought between man and microbes. This has not only led to countless infectious diseases and an inconceivable number of deaths, but has had far-reaching consequences for culture and society. For several years after the Second World War, there was a widespread belief that the era of infectious diseases as a serious threat was over. This turned out to be a formidable miscalculation. Not only have many of the well-known infectious diseases held their own in many parts of the world, but over the past decades we have also encouraged a large number of previously unknown microbes that have caused life-threatening disease problems and, to a certain extent, major epidemics. The HIV, Ebola, SARS, and COVID-19 viruses are just a few characters in the sinister cast of microbes that have appeared on the scene. The mass media constantly comes up with announcements of new infectious diseases and epidemic threats. We now know that the duel between man and microbes is an ongoing affair, and that it will continue for as long as humanity exists on this earth. But we also know far more about the factors that influence the outcome of this eternal duel, including the consequences of the ever-increasing man-made changes to nature around us. The new knowledge gleaned about the connection between infection and ecology is important for our duel against microbes in the future. The new insight into the interaction between man and the world of microbes has shown itself to be useful in trying to understand the history of human infection through the ages. In recent years, we have also seen an increased understanding of the importance of infectious diseases and epidemics for the course of history. This book provides an updated presentation of the eternal duel between man and microbes and the many factors that influence its outcome. I describe the major transitions in the history of human infection from the time when the first representatives of Homo sapiens roamed the African savannas. I also deal with a number of the large epidemics that have affected humanity through history, of which the Black Death is just one of many examples. One chapter is devoted to the significance that many of these epidemics may have had for the downfall of civilizations and empires. Some of the new infectious diseases that were discovered from the second half of the 20th century onwards are dealt with in separate chapters. The book also deals with how man has fought back against microbes via vaccines and antibiotics. Here I describe a number of the microbial threats we will probably have to face in the future, and how we can combat them. This includes the constant threat from new epidemics and pandemics. From the beginning of 2020, the world has been confronting a new pandemic involving a formerly unknown coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2. We have been shown once again the considerable consequences a pandemic has for both the individual and society, an echo from the pandemics of the past that have repeatedly shaken humanity. In the book, I emphasize that the question is not whether we will encounter new pandemics in the future, but when, and which particular microbe from the multifarious world of microbes will be involved. The history of human infectious diseases is dramatic and colorful, but it is also extremely comprehensive and complex. My project may thus appear to be highly ambitious. I have decided to write this book in spite of this for two main underlying reasons. First, as a doctor, I have spent practically all of my working life dealing with infectious diseases and the immune response to microbes, partly as a researcher and partly as a clinician and doctor with patients. For a number of years, I have also worked at many levels on one of the largest pandemics of recent times, the AIDS pandemic. I have been involved in much teaching and have given countless lectures on these subjects. Second, since my childhood, I have had a burning interest in history, one that has not diminished over the years. With this dual background, I succumbed to the temptation to combine my medical and historical interests. The result is this book. It is not an academic thesis intended for specialists. The primary target group is interested readers without previous specialized knowledge. Even so, I have included a number of references for those who might wish to see something of the background of the material I am presenting. If I am able to convey just a fraction of the fascination I myself have for this topic, I will be content. Prologue. The Invisible Enemy. Homo sapiens, our own species of the human race, originally came from Africa. The first fossil finds of human types that manifestly looked like present-day humans were made in Africa and are more than 200,000, perhaps closer to 300,000 years old. About 60,000 years ago, some of our ancestors left Africa and gradually spread out all over the Earth's continents, with the exception of Antarctica. This, until now, has been the prevailing view, but new research finds can be argued to imply that this migration started somewhat earlier, perhaps more than 100,000 years ago. The first humans doubtless faced many threats and challenges. Considerable changes in climate conditions put their adaptability to the test, from tropical conditions on African savannas to much cooler climates in temperate zones. Predatory animals of many kinds threatened our ancestors, including fearsome species that have long since become extinct, such as the saber-toothed tiger and huge types of cave bear. Even so, human beings managed to develop strategies to survive these visible threats, although many lives must unquestionably have been lost in the struggle. From the outset, however, our ancestors were exposed to other threats, at least as dangerous, about which they were unaware. Attacks from invisible enemies, microorganisms that can cause infectious diseases. Bacteria, viruses, fungi, and other microorganisms have been the cause of acute and chronic, deadly and more harmless infections. Throughout our entire history of development, a duel has been taking place between man and microorganisms, a never-ending duel that is still being fought and will continue to be for as long as humans exist on the planet. This duel has had enormous consequences for Homo sapiens, not only from a medical point of view, but on our history, culture, and society. To understand the history of human infections through the ages, it is not sufficient just to look at the two duelists, man and the microbes and their attributes. It has gradually become apparent that the outcome of the duel is very often decided by ecological and environmental relations. This book deals with the interaction between man, microbes, and ecological factors throughout the thousands of years of man's history of infection. 1. The Dualists. The fact that microorganisms such as bacteria and viruses can cause infectious diseases is now common knowledge, a natural part of what we learn as children. The same applies to an understanding of which diseases can be passed on from one person to another. Even so, not all that many years have passed since such views made their breakthrough via a number of epoch-making research finds in the second half of the 19th century. For several hundreds of thousands of years prior to this insight, Homo sapiens has constantly been the victim of a large number of infectious diseases, both acute and chronic, fatal and banal. What ideas did our ancestors have about the cause of such diseases, which quite often took a dramatic course as epidemics with great consequences for society? An important characteristic of our species, one that distinguishes us from other animal species, is the wish to understand the surrounding world and what goes on around us. For that reason, humans have doubtless thought a great deal about the causes of the many diseases that we now know are infections. These early theories about disease were naturally shaped by the prevailing conceptions about the world and the place of humanity within it. Apollo's arrows or miasmas? It seems highly probable that religious ideas, the belief in supernatural forces in nature, and subsequently in various types of God that could intervene in human life, arose during an early stage of human development. The earliest conceptions of the causes of infectious diseases, naturally enough, were that they were a result of the intervention of gods or demons. In the ancient civilizations of Sumer and Babylon in Mesopotamia, and also in China, we find over a period of thousands of years widespread popular belief in demons as the cause of infectious diseases. One important Mesopotamian deity was Nergal, the ruler of the underworld, who was worshipped as the god of fever, plague, and war. Similar concepts were also found in ancient Chinese civilization. In the Old Testament, we find accounts of how Yahweh punished Israel's foes with plagues. The Philistines were punished in this way when they stole the Ark of the Covenant from the temple in Jerusalem, and the Assyrians were struck down by a plague when they threatened to conquer Jerusalem. In the New Testament, demons play an important role in diseases, including infections. In ancient Greece, religious concepts of the causes of disease were important, particularly in the event of epidemics. Here, the god Apollo was a central figure, both as a bringer and curer of disease. He could cause epidemics by taking his bow and shooting plague arrows at people. In the very first book of the Iliad, Homer describes how Apollo sent a plague sweeping through the Greek armies because Agamemnon, the Greek commander, had offended the priest of Apollo. The arrows clanged at his back as the god quaked with rage, the god himself on the march, and down he came like night. Over against the ships he dropped to a knee, let fly a shaft, and a terrifying clash rang out from the great silver bow. First he went for the mules and circling dogs, but then, launching a piercing shaft at the men themselves, he cut them down in droves. And the corpse fires burned on, night and day, no end in sight. In the Iliad, the plague does not cease until Apollo has been pacified. In the tragedy Oedipus the King by Sophocles, the city of Thebes is ravaged by a plague epidemic. The Oracle of Delphi announces that this is the punishment of the gods because the present ruler of the city, Oedipus, has killed the former king, who was his father. It is the patricide that here represents the offense against divine law. The views of Homer and Sophocles were without a doubt in accordance with the people's conceptions of the divine causes of epidemics. These concepts were retained among most people throughout antiquity and the Middle Ages. In Rome, there were no fewer than three temples dedicated to the goddess Febris, who controlled fevers, the most common of which was probably malaria. Even in our own time, we occasionally come across such attitudes in certain religious environments. When the AIDS epidemic broke out in the early 1980s, certain Christian preachers announced that this was the Lord's punishment for ungodly sexual behavior. From antiquity until the present day, in many cultures there have also existed ideas that diseases, including infectious diseases, can be caused by black magic carried out by witches and magicians who are in contact with evil supernatural powers. This has contributed to witch hunts down the ages and still occurs in certain African societies. Sagas from the Norse period in Iceland and Greenland reveal that people also assumed there were supernatural causes of epidemics. There it was believed that the dead, at the outbreak of an epidemic, sought to drag the living along with them into death. Ancient Greece has strongly influenced Western civilization in a great many areas. We have mentioned the religious explanations of the causes of infectious diseases in ancient Greek culture. At the same time, there were early alternative ways of thinking that attempted to understand nature and the place of humanity in it without resorting to religious explanations. The beginnings of natural science arose with the Greek philosophers of nature in the 6th and 7th centuries BC. A recurrent idea found in their works was that the universe consisted of a small number of basic elements that are normally in a state of balance. The same laws that apply to the macrocosm, the world around us, must also apply to the human body, they believed. Some of these philosophers claimed that illness resulted from the balance between the elements or components of the body being disturbed in some way or other. These basic ideas were developed by the semi-mythical doctor Hippocrates of Kos and his many successors. Despite the fact that Hippocrates is indubitably the most famous physician of all time, we know very little about him. He lived and practiced in Athens in the 5th century BC, at roughly the same time as Socrates and Plato, the latter of whom refers to him in a number of his writings as being an excellent physician. The medical teaching ascribed to Hippocrates and his pupils is to be found in the so-called Hippocratic Collection, Corpus Hippocraticum. We do not know which of these, if any, Hippocrates wrote himself. Among other things, they include a discussion of fevers and epidemics as well as their causes. The basis of the views of diseases in the collection, highly simplified, is that illness results from a disturbance of the balance in the body between the most important body fluids, blood, yellow gall, phlegm, mucus, and black gall. Pandemics are caused by the influence of harmful vapors, miasmas in the air. The Greek word miasma means pollution. Such pathogenic miasmas can come from stagnant water and ponds, unhealthy sumps, or the rotting corpses of animals or humans. Miasmas are typically accompanied by a foul stench. There is emphasis on the fact that both the seasons of the year and meteorological factors are significant in epidemics, and that a role is played by the positions of the planets and the stars. People also display individual differences in how susceptible they are to miasmas. The views of diseases expressed in the Hippocratic collection and its teaching on miasmas were developed by Galen, who, alongside Hippocrates, is the most famous physician of antiquity. He was Greek, born in Pergamon in Asia Minor, but practiced in Rome in the mid-2nd century AD and was employed by the philosopher emperor Marcus Aurelius as his personal physician. Galen was to have an enormous influence on European medicine for the next 1,500 years. The teachings of Hippocrates and Galen about diseases were also translated into Arabic in the 8th and 9th centuries and came to have a profound influence on medicine in the Muslim world. The concept that miasmas caused disease survived well into the 19th century, even though the old Hippocratic theories about disease being the result of an imbalance between bodily fluids had gradually been abandoned. From the Enlightenment onwards, there was an increasing belief in the positive influence of hygiene and good sanitary conditions. The ideas that miasmas were a cause of epidemic diseases was one of the driving forces behind the many measures during the 19th century intended to improve the sometimes dreadful sanitary conditions that characterized the rapid growth of cities during industrialization. The pioneers of germ theory. Religious conceptions regarding the causes of what we now consider to be infectious diseases had a firm hold on people's minds from the beginnings of history, while non-religious explanations, such as the belief in miasmas, gradually also came to influence human thought, particularly in the upper echelons of society. These differing conceptions seem to have existed alongside each other. Many infectious diseases are also extremely contagious, yet it is surprising that the existence of contagion was not recognized early on. If we return to the Hippocratic collection, we find detailed descriptions of symptoms and the course of infectious diseases, but there is no evidence anywhere that the author took into account the spread of infection from one person to another. This also applies to learned physicians, it should be noted, in the centuries after Hippocrates and Galen. Were ordinary people unable to observe contagion in their everyday lives during epidemics? Did people blindly accept the scholars' theories? No. Opinions are sometimes expressed supporting the theory that there was some knowledge of contagion being passed from one person to another in infections, and that this characterized people's behavior during epidemics. The first basis for this can be found in the Greek historian Thucydides. In his comprehensive account of the epidemic that ravaged Athens in the 5th century BC, it seems as if he reckoned on the disease being passed from one person to another. And, just as interesting, one gains the impression that he also believed this to be a quite common view among Athenians. We must move forwards more than 1,700 years before we find further evidence that person-to-person contagion was a widely held concept, one that even had political consequences. One of the most famous epidemics of all time, the Black Death, was then ravaging the world. In its wake, an increasing number of European cities, based on the model used for Italian cities, introduced measures that were clearly aimed at preventing the spread of infection. These included the introduction of quarantine. Sailors from newly arrived ships were kept on board, isolated from the population for 40 days to see whether or not they fell ill. The word quarantine comes from the Italian, quaranta giorni, which means 40 days in a Venetian dialect. When syphilis exploded as an epidemic in Europe at the beginning of the 16th century, it was also abundantly obvious to most people that this disease was transmitted from person to person. Although the idea of contagion was clearly accepted in sections of the population, at any rate, as far as certain diseases were involved, the classic teaching of miasmas still prevailed among learned physicians who held on to the legacy of Hippocrates. And even though some of them accepted the idea of contagion with regard to certain diseases, there was, naturally enough, no clear understanding of why and how this occurred. There was, however, one man who diverged greatly from the conventional views of his colleagues. This was the Italian Girolamo Fracastoro, or as he called himself in his Latin writings, Hieronymus Fracastorius. Fracastoro wrote during the first half of the 16th century. In many ways, he was a typical Renaissance figure who excelled at both science and art. He was a physician, indeed the Pope's private physician, a professor of logic at the University of Padua, an astronomer and a poet who wrote in elegant Latin. Two of Fracastoro's works give him a place in the history of medicine, his poem on syphilis, Syphilis Sive Morbus Gallicus, 1530, and his later work, De Contagione et Contagiosis Morbis et Eorum Curatione, on contagion and contagious diseases and their cure, 1546. Fracastoro's poem on syphilis is not some sort of dirty limerick, but an epic in no fewer than three volumes in which he gives a thorough account of the disease, its symptoms, origins, and treatment, and employs the term syphilis for the first time. He also deals with the mechanisms of infection, but does not present his final theories on germs until several years later in the second work, in which he claims that infection is caused by the transmission of extremely small, invisible particles, which he calls seminaria. These can be transmitted directly from person to person via objects such as clothing or through the air. This accords well with our present-day conceptions, and Fracastoro has been praised to the skies in our own age as a visionary pioneer. Others have more soberly pointed out that one cannot know for sure what Fracastoro meant by his seminaria, and that he did not, at any rate, regard them as living organisms. It has also been claimed that Fracastoro was not completely original, since it has been discovered that certain antique writers before him mentioned that disease can be caused by minute creatures or animalcula, as they are called in Latin. At certain points in Galen's comprehensive writings, he also talks about plague seeds, without explaining the basis for this or developing the theme further, to the great frustration of modern Galen scholars. Despite these objections, Fracastoro's theories are interesting. They gave rise to a certain amount of interest in some decades to follow, but were then consigned to oblivion until they were rediscovered with enthusiasm in the 20th century, when he was almost declared to be the father of modern infection medicine. Just over a century after Fracastoro's death in 1553, the Dutch amateur researcher Anton van Leeuwenhoek came up with some epic-making discoveries that, seen in retrospect, ought to have brought Fracastoro to the fore once more and accelerated scientific development towards our present-day view of microbes and infection. Van Leeuwenhoek, who was born in 1632, was a respected draper from Delft. He had no real formal education, but he had a hobby that engrossed him, the use of the microscope for studying nature. He taught himself to make microscope lenses in a new way, and the microscopes he created, of which he had around 200, were considerably better than the somewhat primitive instruments known until then. One day in 1674, he placed a drop of water from a pond under the microscope and, to his amazement, could see a great many minute creatures that were invisible to the naked eye. What he probably saw were a number of single-cell organisms, which today are called protozoa. 2 years later, when he had further improved his microscope, he took a sample from his own gums and placed it under the microscope. He emphasized in his account how meticulous he was with his own oral hygiene. Despite this, he was amazed to see a great number of minute organisms of which he made very precise drawings. There can be no doubt whatsoever that this is history's first description of bacteria, which are even smaller than the protozoa he had seen earlier. Van Leeuwenhoek published his findings and became famous for his discoveries using a microscope. Prominent people from all over Europe wished to look through his microscope, including Tsar Peter the Great of Russia and Queen Mary II of England and Scotland, who were given microscopes as gifts. Van Leeuwenhoek never understood that the small organisms he had discovered could be the cause of disease. He spoke and wrote only Dutch and was unfamiliar with Fracastoro's germ theories. Surprisingly enough, no medical scholars linked these newly discovered bacteria to Fracastoro and infectious diseases. The time was not yet ripe, and Van Leeuwenhoek's small creatures were regarded as an amusing curiosity. The breakthrough and the preceding struggle. Let us move forwards to the first half of the 19th century. Was the world now ready for more modern theories about the transmission of infection by germs? Not at all. Admittedly, people realized in practice that a number of the common infectious diseases such as syphilis, gonorrhea, smallpox, and measles were transmitted from person to person, but this was not linked to the idea of live pathogens. In some countries, the authorities had long since established various quarantine measures to prevent the spreading of epidemics, mainly the big three, the plague, yellow fever, and cholera. But this did not mean that there was any sort of agreement that they were infectious diseases, in the modern sense of the term. People explained the possible effect of quarantine measures by rather ingenious interpretations of the miasma theory. It was not only reactionary and anti-scientific sticks in the mud who were opposed to germ theory. Many of the antagonists were excellent scientists who fought against what they considered to be outdated theories and traditions from earlier times. And they were in a fairly strong position. Even though the belief in contagion had been widespread for centuries, no one had been able to explain how it could actually take place. And the experiences gained from quarantine measures for the major epidemics such as the plague, yellow fever, and cholera did not point unequivocally towards person-to-person infection. Today, we know why. When it comes to the plague and yellow fever, infection from the microbe is normally not from person to person, but via a bite from infection-carrying insects. In the case of cholera, it is usually waterborne. This means that one will often encounter cases where the infected person has not been in contact with patients who are already ill. This was why the classic quarantine measures used from as early as the medieval period did not always work. This was taken to be evidence against person-to-person infection, and it meant that the miasma theory, in updated versions with the emphasis on the importance of comprehensive sanitary measures, seemed considerably more plausible to many people. The miasma theory had gradually been modified to such an extent that it was now thought that the pathogenic miasma contaminants were not only airborne, but could also be transmitted via clothing and objects. Prominent researchers knew about the existence of the microorganisms already demonstrated by Van Leeuwenhoek, but no one had yet convincingly documented that such microbes cause disease in human beings. Furthermore, it had been demonstrated that bacteria could exist in the bodies of completely healthy individuals. Through the somewhat primitive microscopes of the time, all bacteria also looked more or less the same, and it was thought to be hardly probable that there were many different types of bacteria with completely different capacities to cause disease. There were also other factors in the mid-19th century that consolidated the resistance to the theories of contagion by germs. An influential middle class had emerged that was highly involved in international trade and supported economic liberalism without too much intervention from the authorities. All the old quarantine regulations that were still enforced in many places were regarded as being damaging to trade because they could lead to considerable financial loss and, as we have heard, were not even always effective. The opponents of such measures saw themselves as men of the future who were fighting for the freedom of the individual and trade against reactionary and despotic regimes. Their ingrained resistance led to the abolition of a number of quarantine measures in several European countries. Even though political and economic considerations certainly played a role in this debate, there is no doubt that the opponents of germ theory were completely convinced they were right. For that reason, some of them fearlessly carried out experiments by exposing themselves to all kinds of infectious material from patients with diseases such as yellow fever and the plague. Surprisingly enough, no infection resulted in most instances. In certain cases, however, things went badly wrong. One experimenter, for example, died of self-inflicted yellow fever after having survived an attempt to give himself the plague. Often, though, the negative results of these fearless experiments fitted the theory, with people concluding that contagion did not play any role. A final factor that contributed to the polarization between supporters and opponents of germ theory was the dispute about spontaneous generation, a concept that is alien to us now that Charles Darwin and the theory of evolution are part of our schoolday knowledge. The theory of spontaneous generation, the belief that life can come into being out of dead matter, has its roots in antiquity and originally had many supporters. It was believed, for example, that small animals such as mice and frogs could come into being spontaneously from dead, rotting matter. The dispute about spontaneous generation became important because it also reflected the feud between the church and critics of religion, who had become increasingly vociferous from the time of the Enlightenment in the latter half of the 18th century. While Christians held that the idea of spontaneous generation was blasphemy, since only God could create new life, a number of the thinkers of the Enlightenment and their successors supported the theory. In the 19th century, there were still many who were convinced that microorganisms such as bacteria could spontaneously come into being, for example, in rotting matter. Representatives of the two camps were carrying out experiments of varying quality as early as the 18th century to find means of justifying their points of view, without this leading to any unequivocal conclusion. Why was the theory of spontaneous generation of importance for the dispute about germ theory? It was because those people who thought that bacteria could arise out of nothing claimed that this could also take place within the human body, without it having to do with an infection from outside. This idea, which we now know is wrong, was held by highly respected scientists who rejected the theories of contagion and the ability of bacteria to cause disease. Around 1850, the outcome of the hard-fought and at times emotional dispute between opponents and supporters of germ theory and the role of bacteria was still completely undecided. The supporters, however, were not just twiddling their thumbs during this period. A number of new findings were made, based partly on real experiments and partly on meticulous and intelligent observations, that gradually caused those opposing germ theory to beat a retreat, laying the basis for what we can call the bacteriological revolution. Several of these discoveries were made by relatively unknown researchers and doctors, which meant that initially they did not get much publicity. In certain cases, they were also the subject of strong criticism. Let us discuss some of them with fresh eyes. One famous story is that of the British surgeon John Snow and cholera. Europe was still being ravaged by cholera epidemics. Snow had studied the details of a number of these epidemics and had become convinced that the disease must be caused by some infectious substance present in the patient's feces, which infected new individuals via drinking water. During an epidemic in the London district of Soho in 1854, he observed that cholera particularly afflicted those people who fetched water from a particular public water pump in Broad Street, and he became convinced that this must be infected by the contaminant. He persuaded the local authorities to remove the pump handle, which led to a dramatic fall in new cases of cholera. It must be admitted, however, that by then the epidemic was already very much on the decline. Snow did not content himself with this. London's water supply was provided by various private firms that sourced it from the Thames at different points. Snow was able to show that districts supplied by companies that fetched water upstream of London, water that had not been polluted by sewage from the city, suffered far fewer cases of cholera than those where the water was drawn from the Thames inside London. Water that was highly polluted by the then quite primitive refuse and sewage systems. Initially, Snow met with considerable resistance to his germ theory and was unable to have his reports printed in the most recognized periodicals. Gradually, however, his message got home and had practical consequences for the organization of London's water supply. Although Snow could not himself demonstrate the infectious agent that caused cholera, he deserves a place in the history of medicine. His views on cholera infection were admittedly not completely original, but he made an impressive effort to get them confirmed in practice. He has also had a pub named after him in what is now Broadwick Street, even though he was teetotal for most of his life. Far more tragic is the story of the Hungarian obstetrician Ignaz Semmelweis. In the mid-19th century, infections raged in surgical wards in European hospitals. There was an extremely high mortality rate from bacterial infections after operations. One surgeon stated that a patient hospitalized for an operation had a greater risk of dying than a British soldier on the battlefield at Waterloo in 1815. This was also the case in most of the maternity wards, where the risk of childbed fever, which is caused by bacteria, was considerable and led to a high mortality rate. Semmelweis worked in the maternity ward of one of the largest hospitals in Vienna, where he was shocked to observe the high incidence of childbed fever. This maternity ward was divided into two, one where student midwives assisted at the births, and one where medical students were responsible. Semmelweis meticulously recorded the occurrence of childbed fever in the two subwards and was able to show unequivocally that this complication followed the medical students, not the midwives. What could be the reason for this? He discovered that the medical students very often came from maternity ward autopsies. He concluded that the students' hands were probably contaminated with what he called corpse particles, which were then brought into contact with the women's genitals. It was these corpse particles that Semmelweis believed were the cause of childbed fever. He was unaware that these were living microorganisms, but he ordered the students to wash their hands thoroughly in chlorinated water before taking part in births from then on. This led to a dramatic fall in childbed fever at the hospital. An important part of the classic story about Semmelweis is the amount of resistance he encountered from the medical authorities, who doubted his theories and his tragic end in a mental hospital where he was physically maltreated. He died in 1865, probably as the result of a wound infection caused by the very same bacterium he had fought against. To a great many people, Semmelweis has gone down in history as a martyr for new scientific truths, but a great deal of this is myth. He actually won over many supporters who gradually spread his message across Europe. That he also met with some resistance from sections of the medical elite in Vienna is probably correct, but it is not really all that surprising. It calls for a certain amount of personal and social talent to sell completely new and revolutionary truths in science. Semmelweis was probably devoid of such a talent. He was a difficult man who gradually developed major personality disturbances with paranoid characteristics that estranged friends and supporters. Nor was the political climate in Vienna at the time favorable, with considerable antagonism between Austrians and Hungarians, which was hardly an advantage for the Hungarian Semmelweis. Although Semmelweis may not have realized it, one doctor before him had also arrived at the conclusion that childbed fever was caused by an infectious substance. The Scottish doctor Alexander Gordon came to this conclusion around 1790, but was greatly thwarted by his colleagues and ended up a broken man on his brother's farm. A now little-known pioneer who made discoveries that paved the way for later breakthroughs in germ theory and the role of bacteria was the French physician Casimir Joseph Davin. In the 1860s, Davin carried out a series of elegant studies of the bacterial disease anthrax, which raged with serious economic consequences among various kinds of livestock, even occasionally causing death among human beings. He was able to detect the bacteria in the blood of sick animals and show that blood containing the bacteria transmitted the disease to healthy animals. Initially, he met with considerable resistance from the medical profession and was later completely overshadowed by the giant figures Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch, who became dominant in the bacteriological revolution in the second half of the 19th century. Davin, however, was not the only one to make important discoveries that led to major breakthroughs in the understanding of the role of bacteria in diseases. Norway, which in the 19th century must be said to have been quite marginalized in European intellectual life, was able to make a considerable contribution within this area. In 1873, the Norwegian doctor Armer Hansen, who worked at a leprosy hospital in Bergen, made an important discovery. He was profoundly interested in the disease of leprosy, which at the time people assumed was either hereditary or caused by miasmas. Hansen, however, was able to detect under the microscope small rod-like bodies inside cells from sick tissue and concluded that these must be the cause of leprosy. This was the first indication of the leprosy bacterium. A German researcher, Albert Neisser, attempted to steal the honor of the discovery, but today Hansen has gained his rightful place in the history of leprosy, and internationally leprosy is often referred to as Hansen's disease. It must, however, be admitted that Hansen's sense of ethics was not quite at the same level as his talent for research. He attempted to transfer the bacteria into a woman's eye. She already had leprosy, but Hansen wanted to see if she now contracted the same type of leprosy as the patient from whom the bacteria had come. He was given a relatively mild sentence, but lost his position at the leprosy hospital in Bergen. The Toreadors enter the arena. A great many important observations had been made that spoke in favor of transmitted bacteria being of crucial importance for a number of diseases, but as yet there was no irrefutable evidence. The situation in the germ theory dispute in the mid-19th century is reminiscent of a bullfight. During the first rounds of a corrida, as it is called in Spanish, the bull is weakened in various ways by riders with lances, known as picadores, without being defeated. Then comes the climax as the toreador enters the arena. If all now goes well, the bull is killed by an elegant thrust from the toreador's sword, to thunderous applause and music from the tribune. This is called the moment of truth. The researchers whom I have named so far have, in a sense, the role of picadores preparing this moment of truth in the history of germ theory. The ecstatically acclaimed toreadors in the story normally told about the bacteriological revolution are the Frenchman Louis Pasteur and the German Robert Koch. Louis Pasteur was born in 1822, the son of a tanner who had previously fought bravely in Napoleon's army. Louis studied chemistry and eventually became a professor in the subject, in which he made interesting and original finds. Partly as a result of coincidences, he became interested in the mechanisms of fermentation processes, which the authorities claimed were caused exclusively by chemical reactions. Pasteur, however, was able to show that the various forms of fermentation were completely dependent on living microorganisms, yeast, fungi, and bacteria. He proved that different bacteria produced different results of the fermentation. In his laboratory, he managed to cultivate the various bacteria and fungi he was studying. He also demonstrated that certain bacteria caused harmful fermentation in, for example, the brewing of beer, and that one can prevent this by heat treatment, which kills the microorganisms responsible. This is the basis of what later became known as pasteurization of milk, for example, where the treatment deactivates the bacteria that spoil the milk. Pasteur then threw himself into the dispute about spontaneous generation that was still taking place. As his point of departure, he did not believe that spontaneous generation was possible. This phenomenon was also incompatible with his religious beliefs. In a series of elegant experiments, he definitively crushed this centuries-old idea. Once again, via a number of coincidences, Pasteur started to investigate the possible cause of various diseases that destroyed the silkworms that were vital for the economically important silk industry in France. After a considerable number of experiments, he managed to demonstrate that the diseases that affected the silkworms were caused by microorganisms. So it was a case of infection. Pasteur's results were also to be of great consequence for French wine production. This, it goes without saying, brought him great popularity, since according to the current President of the Republic, Emmanuel Macron, wine represents the soul of France. From then on, Pasteur became increasingly interested in microbes as the cause of disease, also in humans, and he devoted the rest of his life to attempts to prove this. He studied infections in animal experiments, and also followed up on Davin's studies of anthrax bacteria. His results also convincingly confirmed the recently published finds by the young Robert Koch, to whom we will return. Pasteur's most important contribution during these years, however, is his epoch-making studies of vaccines for human beings, which in many ways laid the foundation of the triumphs of modern vaccination medicine. We will return later to that part of his contribution, which was just as significant as his fundamental studies of bacteria. Pasteur's historic discoveries of the role of bacteria gained a great deal of attention both in France and abroad. A young British surgeon, Joseph Lister, was among those fascinated by Pasteur's finds. Like other surgeons of the time, he was greatly interested in the post-operative infection of wounds, which was a major problem as it led to a high mortality rate. Lister had the idea that wound infections were quite simply caused by surrounding bacteria that got into the wounds, leading to harmful processes of the same type as Pasteur had proved took place in fermentation. He believed that it must be sensible to treat such infections with germicidal substances and chose the chemical substance phenol, which he applied directly to wounds from operations and also used as a spray in the air around the patient. His results showed convincingly that phenol had an effect. Lister's methods were very soon adopted on the continent, first in Germany, then in France. In Britain and the USA, on the other hand, he initially met with considerable skepticism. Among other things, this was because of a certain distrust of the theories of bacteria and germs in general in the world of medicine. Gradually, however, Lister gained full recognition as a pioneer, and he was given the title Baron Lister by Queen Victoria in 1897. The dedicated work carried out by him and other surgeons in combating wound infections has been of enormous importance for the development of surgery over the past 150 years. We now come to Pasteur's great rival, the other true giant of the bacteriological revolution, Robert Koch. Early in his medical career, he became fascinated by infectious diseases, including cholera, with which he became familiar during an epidemic, as well as the wound infections that he experienced as an army doctor during the Franco-Prussian War of 1870 to 1871. As a practicing local doctor in the small town of Wolsztyn, now Wolsztyn in Poland, he became interested in the disease anthrax, which at the time was ravaging flocks of sheep and also causing a number of human fatalities. Koch's wife gave him a microscope as a present on his 29th birthday. He set up a somewhat primitive, improvised laboratory separated from his doctor's surgery by a curtain, and with hardly any contact with other research environments, made a number of fundamental discoveries showing that anthrax was caused by a bacterium. Like Davin before him, Koch found the bacterium in the blood of sick animals. He managed to cultivate it and was able to transmit the disease to experimental animals via the bacteria. He further discovered that the bacterium could mutate into spores, a kind of dormant state that was extremely hardy and capable of surviving for a long time in nature before they once more converted to fatal bacteria, which could infect both animals and humans. Koch published his anthrax finds in 1876. This must be regarded as one of the great breakthroughs in the history of infection medicine, since it was the first time that anyone had been able to show that bacteria cause disease in humans. The discovery caused quite a stir, although some people doubted the findings. As mentioned, Pasteur was able to definitively confirm them somewhat later. Koch followed this up with a number of new discoveries that laid much of the foundations of modern bacteriology. He launched a series of new cultivation methods for bacteria and devised staining methods that could easily demonstrate them. He also contributed to technical improvements to microscopes, which proved very important for the further study of bacteria. Today, it may seem strange that several prominent researchers at the time claimed that there was only one type of bacterium that could mutate into other bacteria. With his extremely thorough studies of, among other things, various kinds of wound infection, Koch was able to completely refute such assertions. A large number of different bacteria exist, and dissimilar bacteria cause different types of infection. This also agreed with Pasteur's findings concerning the role of different bacteria in fermentation. Then came perhaps Koch's finest hour, his discovery of the bacterium that causes tuberculosis. Anthrax was a relatively uncommon infection in human beings and mainly played a role in agriculture. Tuberculosis, on the other hand, was an extremely widespread disease, responsible at the time for one death in every seven in Europe. The theory that it might be an infectious disease was not completely new. A French army doctor, Jean Villemont, had shown as early as 1865, through epoch-making experiments, that he could transmit tuberculosis by injecting rabbits with diseased tissue from tuberculosis patients. But he was unable to prove the existence of any bacterium, and so his findings were treated with skepticism. Koch was convinced that there had to be a tuberculosis bacterium in the diseased tissue from patients, one that was not visible using his usual dyeing methods for bacteria. Via meticulous trial-and-error methods, he managed to create a completely new dyeing method, which convincingly demonstrated the existence of bacteria in tissue from both humans and experimental animals with tuberculosis infection. After further laborious experiments, Koch also managed to cultivate these tuberculosis bacteria. He subsequently showed that experimental animals he infected with the bacteria developed typical signs of tuberculosis. In March 1882, Robert Koch presented his tuberculosis finds at the scientific gathering in Berlin. His audience, which counted several celebrities from the research world, were almost speechless with admiration. A later Nobel Prize winner who was present, Paul Ehrlich, stated that this was the most important experience of my life as a scientist. In the course of a couple of months, Koch had become internationally famous. Shortly after his success with tuberculosis, however, Koch took up a new challenge, cholera. Cholera still gave rise to serious epidemics with high mortality and had now descended on Egypt. After a request from the Egyptian government, research teams from Germany led by Koch and from France under one of Pasteur's men traveled to Egypt. Koch and his assistants managed to detect the cholera bacterium in a patient's intestinal system in 1883. He also managed to cultivate the bacterium and show that in all probability it was transmitted via polluted drinking water. When the epidemic had peaked in Egypt and the number of patients was on the decrease, Koch and his team continued their studies of cholera in India. On their return home to Germany, they were celebrated as heroes. The French group, however, was completely unsuccessful and had to return home crestfallen after one of their team had died of cholera. This was a new humiliation for France after its defeat in the Franco-Prussian War. Despite Koch's extremely thorough studies of cholera, many still doubted his finds, partly because no one was initially able to infect experimental animals with the cholera bacterium. One prominent critic was the influential German scientist Max von Pettenkofer. He had developed a highly complex variant of the miasma theory as an explanation of cholera and was not prepared to accept that the bacterium could cause the disease on its own. He requested a bacterium sample from Koch, which he then drank. He did not contract cholera. Despite this negative result, which von Pettenkofer exploited to the maximum, it became increasingly clear over the next few years that Koch was right. After years of worsening depression, von Pettenkofer shot himself in 1901. After several years of important administrative work as a professor, Koch returned to his study of tuberculosis. This time he worked on developing a groundbreaking treatment for the disease. After 1 year's intense work in the laboratory, he announced at a research convention in August 1890 that he had found a bactericidal substance that halted tuberculosis in animal experiments. He did not initially reveal that this was tuberculin, an extract of tubercle bacteria in glycerol that was injected into the subcutis. The reason he kept the tuberculin recipe secret was that he wished to earn money from selling it and did not want any competition from other researchers. Koch gave this tuberculin to a number of patients with tuberculosis and claimed, on the flimsy basis of rather unsystematic experiments, that the treatment had a dramatic effect. This cure commanded enormous international attention, and Koch was once more acclaimed, at least at first. The announcement of the new tuberculosis treatment led to tremendous enthusiasm. In one of Germany's most prestigious medical journals, Koch was compared with St. George, who slayed the dragon. The illustration depicted Koch on his horse, named Science, attacking the tuberculosis bacterium with his sword, the microscope. Thousands of tuberculosis patients flocked to Berlin to be treated, with the hotel capacity of the city almost at bursting point. Koch persuaded the government to set up a new institute for infectious diseases with himself as head. He gradually formed a large team of excellent colleagues who, over the next few years, made a great many discoveries in the field of bacteria, including identifying the bacteria that cause such major infections as typhoid fever, diphtheria, tetanus, pneumonia, and meningitis. Koch and his team also inspired many other researchers to seek bacterial causes for diseases. The 30 years that followed Koch's discovery of the anthrax bacterium could well be called the golden age of the history of bacteriology. Koch's launch of tuberculin as a treatment for tuberculosis, however, proved to be a disaster for both him and for his patients. By the end of 1890, it began to be clear that Koch's acclaimed treatment had no convincing effect. Tuberculin caused fever in the patients and occasionally marked allergic reactions that could be serious, but did not lead to a cure. It is surprising that Koch's usual critical sense deserted him during this period, and we do not have any convincing explanation as to why this occurred. Was this a modern version of what the ancient Greeks called hubris, overweening pride that was punished by the gods? When enthusiasm for the tuberculosis treatment dwindled, Koch's prestige also faded and his marriage collapsed. But he rose again after the tuberculin fiasco and made further important research contributions, especially in the field of tropical infections. His reputation was re-established and he was awarded a well-deserved Nobel Prize in 1905. A retrospective look at the bacteriological revolution. The breakthrough in modern germ theory linked to the convincing demonstration of bacteria as the cause of infectious diseases was a milestone in the history of medicine, a revolutionary development that was to have tremendous consequences for the prevention and treatment of such diseases. It also overthrew 2,500 years of quite literally airy miasma thinking. If one is to be pedantic, the term revolution is not quite accurate, since this radical change in the traditional view of illness, as we have heard, took many decades. When one speaks of revolution, certain key figures are often emphasized in the historical presentation. The Russian Revolution has its Lenin and Trotsky, the French its Robespierre and Danton. One often forgets all the others who also contributed to the breakthrough of the revolution. In the most conventional historical presentation of the bacteriological revolution, it is quite clear that Pasteur and Koch are considered giants, while all the others who contributed and tilled the soil for the breakthrough are consigned to the shadows and partly forgotten. I have earlier compared them to the picadors in a bullfight, which culminates with the coup de grace, the moment of truth from the toreadors Pasteur and Koch. Naturally, it is unjust to ignore all these other proficient and partly visionary researchers who often have been given only walk-on status in the historical narrative. I have mentioned some, but could well have mentioned many more. There is further good reason not to ignore the many people who contributed to the feats of the giants. Popular representations of science generally have a tendency to focus exclusively on the efforts of a few key individual figures, resulting from ostensibly genius-like inspiration. This is well illustrated by the anecdotes about Archimedes leaping triumphantly out of his bath after having realized the law of the upward buoyancy force of a body immersed in water, and Isaac Newton, who recognized the law of gravity after seeing an apple fall to the ground. The truth is that all these researchers, even the most brilliant ones, base their findings on earlier work. Research is a laborious task, placing one stone on top of another. This also applies to a high degree to the intellectual contributions that led to the bacteriological revolution. Even so, there can be no doubt that both Pasteur and Koch deserve their towering position in the history of infection medicine. They were truly impressive researchers with vision, iron-hard discipline, and, not least, an enormous capacity for work. It is said that when Pasteur was working late in the laboratory as usual, some of his young assistants would hear the master muttering a particular sentence time and time again. To find out if this was the magic formula for success, one of them concealed himself behind a curtain and learned by heart the magic words that Pasteur constantly repeated. Il faut travailler. Il faut travailler. Work must be done. Work must be done. Pasteur in particular has been granted hero status to such an extent that people have spoken of the pasteurization of France. Both Pasteur and Koch also possessed another quality that is useful for success in research, the ability to market one's discoveries and oneself and to stay on good terms with the leading politicians. Both of them were tough polemicists with their opponents. Pasteur was once even challenged to a duel by an infuriated old surgeon he had provoked. It is hardly surprising that a lifelong hostility existed between the two stars in the firmament of infection medicine. This was probably due partly to subject-related rivalry between two highly ambitious researchers, a not uncommon phenomenon in science. But it was also caused by the highly tense relationship between France and Germany both before and after the Franco-Prussian War, which ended in French humiliation. Pasteur furiously returned a gold medal he had formerly received from the university in Bonn. What we can call the golden age of the bacteriological revolution laid the foundation for a comprehensive international research process which gradually broadened the field with the discovery of new microbes as well as bacteria, viruses, protozoa, fungi, and prions. This we will return to later. Accounts of the bacteriological revolution often concentrate on the consequences for modern infection medicine and the treatment of patients. This, in a sense, is scarcely surprising, for the consequences within these areas have been tremendous. Even though this book concentrates on the purely medical aspects of the never-ending duel between humanity and the world of microbes, it is nevertheless important to remember that active research in this field over the past 150 years has increased our total sum of knowledge about the world far beyond the field of infection medicine. Studies of bacteria in particular have given us new and valuable knowledge about the life processes of all living cells. We have gained insight into the vital importance of microbes for the maintenance of all life on the planet, animal as well as plant. Furthermore, we have learned to make use of bacteria in the production of new medication. It is also probable that bacteria and viruses will be able to be used in completely new forms of treatment for a number of diseases, including various forms of cancer. Viruses, in particular, are included in many forms of gene therapy that are showing great promise for the treatment of a series of diseases. The multitudinous world of microbes. It is first and foremost the duel between man and microbes that is our theme. The term microbe or microorganism means an organism that is not visible with the naked eye, only with a microscope. But Homo sapiens and other living creatures can also be subject to infection by organisms that are clearly visible without a microscope, various forms of parasitic worm. For this reason, I use the term microbes in a broader sense, one that also includes these parasitic worms, which are the cause of many common and serious diseases. Before presenting the various forms of microbes known as pathogens, which are of interest as causes of infection and disease, let us start at the beginning with the origins of life. The primeval soup and the beginning of life. The formation of our planet is estimated to have taken place somewhere between 4.5 and 5 billion years ago. For the first billion years, no life existed. The Earth was almost an inferno. The temperature was extremely high, the atmosphere lacked oxygen and probably consisted of such gases as carbon dioxide, CO2, nitrogen, hydrogen, and methane. There were violent volcanic eruptions, electric storms with lightning strikes, and bombardment by meteorites. There was no protective ozone layer in the atmosphere, which meant that the Earth's surface was continuously exposed to ultraviolet and cosmic radiation. Despite these highly inhospitable conditions, something happened to the warm seas after a billion years when the planet had cooled to a certain extent. With the water no longer existing as vapor, a form of life arose that marked the beginning of everything subsequently alive on our planet. There are many more or less well-founded theories as to how this took place, but these lie outside the scope of this book. The prevalent theory during the past 80 years has been that the first bacteria arose in the seas of that time, also known as the primeval soup, about 3.5 to 4 billion years ago. For the next 3 billion years, bacteria were the only form of life on Earth. They made good use of their time. Numerous new forms developed according to the eternal laws of evolution, and the extremely hardy bacteria gradually conquered every nook and cranny of the planet. As mentioned, the atmosphere lacked oxygen for the first billions of years. But about 2 billion years ago, the concentration of oxygen began to increase considerably. This was because bacteria had now emerged that could use energy from sunlight to convert water and hydrogen into chemical energy in the process we now know in plants, photosynthesis, resulting in the production of oxygen. Gradually, some of the bacteria learned how to use oxygen in the production of energy, and this proved to be far more efficient than earlier forms of energy production. The foundation had now been laid for the next major event in the history of life on the planet, the development of what are called eukaryotic cells, about 1.5 billion years ago. This form of cell is the basis for all life forms other than bacteria, which are known as prokaryotic cells. The new eukaryotic cells were definitely derived from bacteria, but they broke away from the bacterial world and developed further, with Homo sapiens as the final result so far. There are fundamental differences between the prokaryotic bacterial cells and the eukaryotic cells we find in plants and animals, including humans. Bacterial cells are smaller and much more primitive than eukaryotic cells, which have a cell nucleus that contains the genetic material, DNA, made up of a number of chromosomes. Bacteria lack a cell nucleus and have their hereditary material, also DNA, on a single circular chromosome that swims freely in the cytoplasm, the cell fluid that is surrounded by the cell membrane. While bacteria nearly always have their own cell wall outside the cell membrane, the former is lacking in eukaryotic cells. There are also a great number of other basic differences, including propagation and metabolic processes, between the two types of cell. After a billion years, the eukaryotic cells began to combine for their mutual benefit, and the next great leap occurred in the development of life, multicellular organisms in which the individual cells gradually began to specialize in various directions and to form various organs. And as the saying goes, the rest is history, even though there are still a great many blank pages in this history book. Bacteria, the first inhabitants of the planet. Bacteria, then, are single-cell organisms that can only be seen under a microscope, since their size varies between 0.2 and 10 picometers. Today, there are around 12,000 species of named bacteria. Despite this, there is no doubt that the number of bacteria species is far greater. They have just not been discovered and studied as yet. Bacteria are found everywhere on the earth, even under the harshest conditions, in sources of boiling water, deep under the polar ice, in extremely saline or extremely acid lakes and on the seabed, as well as deep down in the earth under the pressure of many atmospheres. Among all these types of bacteria, only a few, around 1,400 perhaps, cause disease in human beings. There is enormous variety in the world of bacteria as regards their characteristics and their role in nature. One property, however, they all have in common, a virtuoso capacity to adapt themselves. For billions of years, this adaptability has been a unique survival factor for bacteria, but it also makes pathogenic bacteria dangerous opponents of humanity. This great capacity for adaptation has to do with the way bacteria reproduce and deal with genetic material, genes. Bacteria reproduce by the cell dividing once it has doubled in size, resulting in two daughter cells with identical chromosomes. Cell division takes place quite frequently in most bacteria, every 13 minutes in the case of cholera, for example. Not infrequently, mutations or changes take place in the DNA molecules. This changes the genetic information and sometimes the characteristics of the bacterium. The genetic information, hereditary material of the bacteria, however, is not only linked to DNA on the single chromosome. Many bacteria, in addition to their one chromosome, also have single circular DNA molecules, plasmids, with extra genetic information that can be useful to the bacterium. This plasmid-borne genetic information can be exchanged between single bacteria by plasmids being transmitted to an adjacent bacterium via the formation of a pipe-shaped channel between them. In this way, the recipient acquires new genes. Bacteria can also freely pick up DNA from dead bacteria in their surroundings. Finally, a bacterial cell can have new hereditary material transmitted to it if it is attacked by special types of virus known as bacteriophages, something we will return to later. So, bacteria have a number of different ways to quickly change their DNA, that is, their genetic material. This makes them particularly well-suited to the evolutionary process and contributes to a major problem in today's infection medicine, the constantly increasing number of bacteria that are resistant to present-day antibiotics. Viruses, small but dynamic players in the life processes. Already in the golden age of bacteriology, when constantly new pathogenic bacteria were being discovered, people were well aware that bacteria could not be detected in a number of diseases that were clearly infections. For some of these suspected infectious diseases, measles, smallpox, influenza, mumps, it was possible to show that a contagious agent was present in material from patients after filtering that removed bacteria. These agents, therefore, had to be extremely small particles, much smaller than bacteria. They were given the name viruses. A virus, with just a small number of exceptions, is far smaller than a bacterium and cannot be seen using an ordinary light microscope. Virus particles only became visible with the arrival of the electron microscope in 1932. Viruses are probably the most numerous of all microorganisms on our planet. They are far simpler in their construction than bacteria. The hereditary material, the genes, consists of either DNA or RNA. It is surrounded by a kind of capsule, capsid, of proteins. Many viruses also have an outer membrane, the viral envelope. Are viruses living organisms? People disagree about this, but the answer depends to a great extent on how life is defined. If the ability to reproduce is a sign of life, viruses must be said to be living. If, on the other hand, one believes that a living organism must be able to reproduce completely on its own, then viruses are non-living. A characteristic all viruses share is that they can only reproduce within living cells. This happens when viral particles penetrate cells after having latched onto specific molecules on the surface of the cell that act as door openers, so the virus can enter the cell. After this, it takes over control of the cell and forces it to start to produce numerous new virus particles, specified according to the virus's own genetic material. The newly produced virus particles leave the cell and can infect new cells. Very frequently, the host cell dies during this process, which one could describe as the microbe world's version of hijacking. The special lifestyle of the viruses accounts for their cardinal importance for all living beings on the planet. A virus can infect all forms of life, bacteria, plants, and animals. Virus genes are very often absorbed into the genetic material of many forms of life after a former visit. One could say that it has left behind its calling card as DNA in the cell. This may have had a great influence on the processes of evolution. With their ability to destroy and break down infected cells, viruses also contribute to the never-ending and absolutely necessary cycle of nutrients in nature. Only a few representatives of the vast world of viruses, until now at any rate, have caused diseases in humans. On the other hand, many of the pathogenic viruses cause some of the most serious infectious diseases. Some viruses are among the classic causes of widespread epidemics with a high infection rate, such as the smallpox, measles, and influenza viruses. The origin of viruses is mysterious. Are they a form of degenerate bacteria that have lost the ability to manage completely on their own? Or do they come from plasmids, the small ring-shaped DNA structures that are often found in bacteria? Nobody knows for sure. Protozoa, the first animals. Protozoa, Greek for the first animals, are unicellular organisms which, unlike bacteria, are eukaryotic, as is the rest of the animal and plant world. Among other things, this means that unlike bacteria, they have their own cell nucleus and a more complex metabolism. Certain protozoa are about the same size as bacteria, while others are somewhat larger. There are more than 200,000 different species of protozoa, but only a few cause disease in humans. However, these diseases are often widespread and serious, such as malaria, amoebic dysentery, and African sleeping sickness. As disease-causing microbes, protozoa are extremely effective. It is difficult for our immune system response to combat them. They are also more difficult to treat with drugs than bacteria. This is because their metabolism is more similar to that of humans than that of bacteria is. Most pathogenic protozoa are to be found in tropical regions. The increase of international travel has increased the incidence of these infections in Western countries. The constant increase in patients with a reduced immune response has also contributed to this, as we shall hear. Fungi, the cause of both banal and life-threatening infections. Fungi are unicellular or multicellular organisms that, like human cells, are eukaryotic. They differ from human cells in that they have a solid capsule outside their cell membrane. Of the 250,000 species that exist, only a few cause disease in humans. Some fungal infections cause quite trivial skin problems, such as ringworm or athlete's foot, while others are some of the most serious infections we know in medicine, with a mortality in patients of almost 100%. It is mainly patients with a reduced immune response that are struck down by these life-threatening infections. Parasitic worms, large and small causes of infection. Parasitic worms are one of the commonest causes of human infection. Such infections are extremely common in tropical regions, but we also have a few forms in other parts of the world, quite harmless ones on the whole. Parasitic worms are multicellular organisms which, unlike the other organisms that cause infectious disease in humans, are visible to the naked eye. They are between 1 centimeter and 10 meters in length. Many of them have quite a complex life cycle, with the human being as merely the intermediate stage between various species of animal that the worm can infect. Infectious diseases caused by parasitic worms vary from relatively harmless, often chronic intestinal infections, to life-threatening diseases in inner organs such as the liver and the brain. Examples of serious infections are trichinosis, which one can get from eating infected pork, schistosomiasis, which one can get from contact with infected water, and tapeworm, with which one can be infected by eggs in animal feces. Prions, deadly protein molecules. Prions represent the smallest and most primitive cause of infectious disease and were not discovered until a few decades ago. They can hardly be called living organisms since they probably only consist of a single protein molecule, do not have their own genetic material, and cannot reproduce without a host organism. The prion protein has the forbidding characteristic that it attacks an almost identical molecule that is normally found in the central nervous system and converts it into a new prion molecule where the amino acid sequence is the same, but the three-dimensional structure is abnormal. This gradually leads to the destruction of nerve cells via a kind of domino effect, with an increasing number of normal protein molecules being transformed. In both animals and humans, prions give rise to some quite rare and as yet incurable diseases that particularly attack the brain and spinal cord. So-called mad cow disease, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or BSE, is one example. Another is chronic wasting disease, CWD, in the deer family, including reindeer and elks in North America and Scandinavia. Prion diseases are infectious but can also be hereditary. Evolution and microbial invasion. From the time the first bacteria, the very first inhabitants of the planet, appeared, they displayed an impressive adaptability and occupied every conceivable place of residence. Then new forms of life emerged. Protozoa, multicellular organisms, and in particular viruses. The bacteria doubtless quickly saw new possibilities to develop in the new forms of life, which they invaded with great success using their adaptive powers. Viruses also greedily fed on the other fauna, so that there is scarcely any form of life on Earth that is not infected by viruses, very often with ruinous consequences for the host cells. The world of plants has not managed to avoid the virtuoso invasive capacity of microbes. The result of invasion of other forms of life by microbes was sometimes peaceful coexistence to the benefit of both parties, and sometimes disease and damage for the host. This is also the situation for the interaction between bacteria and Homo sapiens, and probably also for our relation to the other microbes that invade us, viruses, fungi, and protozoa. From the very beginning of time, then, a constant interaction has existed between the forms of life in which the various players, subject to the laws of evolution, have constantly faced challenges from their opponents via new adaptations, which in turn lead to countermeasures. Humanity was inexorably drawn into this ancient process. Microbes and humankind. The entire series of developments of multicellular organisms that has resulted in Homo sapiens has, over hundreds of millions of years, been invaded by microbes. We initially inherited a microbe repertoire from our immediate ancestors, ape men. Subsequently, our challenges from the world of microbes have constantly changed, partly through the evolutionary adaptations that have governed the interaction between microbes and host organisms, and partly through ecological and environmental relations that, to a great extent, control this interaction. Microbes as allies. Our main theme is the ability of the world of microbes to cause infectious diseases. Even so, it is necessary to emphasize that the invasion by microbes does not necessarily cause disease, but can, on the contrary, be useful, even vitally necessary. Our knowledge about this is the result of quite intensive research into what is called the microbiota, the total microbial mass that at all times exists in a healthy human body in the digestive channel, particularly the intestines, on the skin, in the air passages, and in the birth canal in women. The microbiota consists of bacteria, viruses, protozoa, and fungi, but until now it is the bacteria that have been studied most intensively. We reckon on there being more than one bacterium for each of our own body cells. In total, we each carry more than a kilogram of bacteria around with us. In our intestines alone, which have been studied most, since one finds by far the most bacteria there, it is estimated that there are about 1,000 different species of bacteria. As each species of bacteria has about 2,000 genes, we thus have far more bacterial genes than the 23,000 human genes in our bodies. This gene mass is called the microbiome. These genes find expression via the generation of a great many bacterial products in the intestines. The microbiome has important functions in the human body. It protects it against alien pathogenic microbes, contributes to our digestive processes, and produces inflammation-suppressing substances. The bacteria in the intestines also produce important nutrients, such as vitamins and amino acids. New and fascinating research has also shown that the microbiome in the intestines, via its metabolism products, can influence other areas of the body, including the function of the brain. Conversely, the brain, via its nerve paths and own hormones, can affect the intestines and the microbes there, the microbiota. Animal experiments have also shown that the microbiome seems to be of great importance for the normal development of both the brain and the immune system. We must assume that this also applies to humans. The exploration of the role of the microbiome is still only in its infancy, but the results so far are extremely promising for an understanding of both the normal function of the human body and the development of various diseases connected to disruptions in the microbiota, such as diabetes and obesity, and the possibility of new methods of treatment in the future, based on manipulation of the microbiota. Microbes and disease. Even though microbes do not always cause disease when they invade us, and even though the great majority of microbes are not the cause of infections, it is a fact that some microbes within all the main groups, bacteria, viruses, protozoa, fungi, and prions, do cause infections in humans. Some of these infections have been with our ancestors ever since they took their first step out of the African rainforest and onto the savanna. Others arose later in connection with the changed life conditions for humanity. And many of them have had great consequences for the human race, not just in the medical field, but for the historical, cultural, and psychological development of man. They have also influenced the development of the human race more directly by affecting our genetic material. How can microbes exert such a strong influence? Let us first examine the mechanisms microbes make use of to invade the human organism, for this is, of course, the first necessary step in developing an infection. In other words, how does infection occur? The paths of microbial infection. The impressive adaptability of microbes is shown by their often fantastic ability to find ways of entering the human body. Most microbes have specialized within individual paths of infection, but we also have plenty of examples of a microbe using various alternative ways. The first obvious question to ask is where the invading microbes come from. Where are they before invading a victim? Here there are various possibilities. Microbes that cause infection can come from other people who transmit the microbe involved. Such a source of infection need not be a sick person, but might be a healthy carrier. Healthy disease carriers play an important role in many epidemics. There is often a far greater number of healthy disease carriers in society than those who become ill because of the microbe in question. An example of this is the pneumococcus bacterium, which can cause inflammation of the lungs and membranes of the brain. But the source of infection does not have to be other human beings. Animals can also carry microbes that affect humans and cause infection. This applies to common and serious infections such as yellow fever, Ebola, and the classic plague. In these cases, the microbe causes the infection in the species of animal concerned, where the animals are reservoirs for the microbe, and we speak of zoonoses, animal infections. Zoonoses have played a very important role in the history of human infection and are still extremely topical. We now know that many of the most important microbes that have caused infection problems throughout history originally come from animals. Certain pathogenic microbes can also live freely in nature and only cause infection if humans are unlucky enough to come into contact with them. One example of this is the bacterium that causes tetanus, which is found in soil. Another is the bacterium that causes Legionnaire's disease, which is found in water. Microbes can gain entry into our body via various paths of infection as the first stage in the infection process. Let us briefly discuss the most important of these paths, since the many evolution-related environmental factors that are crucial in infection medicine often act by influencing the infection paths of microbes. Many microbes infect via direct contact between human beings. This can be via intimate, such as sexual contact, or via what is known as droplet infection, when an infected person coughs or sneezes, so that small droplets containing microbes are flung out into the surrounding air and inhaled by the person exposed. Direct infection can also take place if pathogenic bacteria in the soil or in water come into contact with open wounds, as in the case of tetanus, and via bites by infected animals, as in the case of rabies. Children can also be directly infected by the mother during pregnancy or via breast milk. HIV infection is an important example of both types. Many microbes can transmit infection through the air over greater distances than droplet infection, which can only operate within a radius of about 1 meter. Small particles that contain microbes, either extremely small droplets or very finely divided aerosol dust particles, are breathed in by the person exposed. Such small particles can remain in the air for quite a long time and be spread over considerable distances. Tuberculosis and measles are examples of this. Particles containing microbes that cause airborne infection can also come from skin rashes with particles of dried scabs, such as chickenpox and smallpox. Infection via the mouth or intestines from polluted food or water is also of great importance. This is the usual form of infection for microbes that cause intestinal infections, from banal diarrhea to such life-threatening infections as cholera. Since infection is via the intake of food or drink polluted by feces, one often talks about fecal-oral infection. This is how another serious viral infection, polio, often occurs. Infection can also take place through the transmission of microbes via various objects, such as polluted toys, clothing, bed linen, and medical instruments. In a medical context, this can take place via blood transfusions and blood products. This has occurred before with the HIV virus and viruses that cause inflammation of the liver, hepatitis B and hepatitis C. The same can happen with drug abuse through the sharing of infected syringes. The last of the important paths of infection is transmission via stinging or biting insects that transport microbes from infection-carrying humans or animals to the next victim. The great classic example of this in human history is the plague, whose bacteria were passed on through fleas. Malaria and yellow fever are today more important examples of insect-transmitted infectious diseases than the plague. In both instances, species of mosquito transmit the microbe. Our immune system, an exceedingly sophisticated defense system. For millions of years, all the various forms of life on the planet were threatened by invasion from microbes in a never-ending struggle of all against all. In many instances, the invasion ended in peaceful coexistence, but the possibility of harm and death resulting from infection has always been there. So it is not surprising that even in the most primitive of life forms, we find early defense mechanisms against infection. During the process of evolution, we see that multicellular organisms gradually develop an increasingly complex immune system based on specialized cells and molecules. Let us be confident enough to say that the human immune system represents the high point of this process. The investigation of the human immune system began with a number of basic discoveries at roughly the same time as the bacteriological revolution. Many of the pioneers belonged to the circles around Pasteur and Koch, or were influenced by the revolutionary discoveries made by these giant figures and their colleagues and pupils. Over the past 130 years, knowledge of the immune system, immunology, has gradually increased and acquired major importance, particularly in medicine. The medical use of immunological discoveries got rapidly underway in the second half of the 20th century. Today, immunology is an important complementary subject within many disciplines of medicine, particularly that of infection. We know much about the role of the immune system in the defense against infection, as well as the consequences of our immune system or important parts of it failing to function. Although we still lack a great deal of knowledge of this unusually complex system, we know a great deal more than we did only a few decades ago, thanks to intensive research. From cradle to grave, at every second of the day and night, we are in constant contact with a great number of different microbes in the air, in what we eat and drink, and on many of the objects with which we are in contact. And we have large quantities of microbes as permanent guests on our mucous membranes and skin. Even though the vast majority of these are harmless and never cause infection, we regularly encounter some that can be pathogenic if the conditions are right. Despite this, not even these microbes are always able to get the better of otherwise healthy individuals. Most of us in Western countries manage to get through life with only a few of the more serious infectious diseases, mainly because of our immune system. This system consists of various types of highly specialized cell, white blood cells, and a great many molecules that to a significant extent are produced by the cells of the immune system and are utterly vital for their proper functioning. The different types of white blood cell in the immune system have various tasks in the defense against the microbes we face as an infection threat. The key to the success of the immune system in the human defense against infection is an intimate cooperation between the various cell types. This takes place partly via direct cell-to-cell contact and partly by the cells releasing various kinds of signal molecule that can take a message from one type of cell to another and alter the function of the recipient cell. Cytokines are a large and important group of these signal molecules. Some of them can stimulate other immune cells while others can inhabit them. Certain cytokines can also influence other cells in the body outside of the immune system itself. The cells of the immune system are distributed among most tissues and organs of the body, including the blood. They are to a great extent localized in lymph tissue, where lymph nodes, spleen and thymus, are important, as well as the lymph tissue in the mucous membranes of the intestinal canal. For the sake of simplicity, we can divide the immune system into two main parts on the basis of tasks and function. One part that is responsible for so-called natural or innate immune response, and one that mediates so-called acquired immune response. The two parts do not, however, operate separately. They cooperate closely. Both parts of the immune system have the capacity to react to certain substances that are foreign to the body and that are found on microbes which can invade the body. This ability to distinguish between our own and foreign molecules is crucial for the proper function of the immune system. It is particularly well developed in cells that mediate acquired immunity. Natural immune response is the first line of defense against invading microbes, and it is rapid in its response. This part of the immune system is extremely old, at least 2 billion years, and we see the first signs of it in extremely simple cellular forms of life. The cells here, the advance guard in the battle, attack the microorganisms in various ways and often manage to overcome and kill them. The battle can then be called off. A key cell among these frontline soldiers is the macrophage, Greek, large eater, which has the ability to swallow many microbes and subsequently kill them. Another important cell type is the neutrophil granulocyte. Also important to this line of defense against viruses are NK lymphocytes, a type of white blood cell which also have a role in combating cancer cells that arise in the body. I must confess that these cells have a particular nostalgic appeal for me. As a laboratory researcher in the early 1970s, I took part in the detection of this type of cell, which were then called K lymphocytes, an abbreviation of killer lymphocytes, and sometimes the third type of lymphocyte, since they have characteristics that distinguish them from both B and T lymphocytes, which are white blood cells vital to the acquired immune response. If the microbes cannot be defeated quickly and the infection shows signs of spreading, the acquired immune response, the heavily armed main troops, is activated. This takes place via direct contact with the cells of the frontline defense as well as via signals communicated by the cytokine molecules that are released by these cells. In the further combating of the microbe, the natural and acquired immune responses continue to cooperate. The acquired immune response is much younger than the natural response, being only 500 million years old. It is found in all higher species of animal. This immune response comes several days after initial contact with a microbe, but becomes increasingly strong as new cells are constantly mobilized and join the fray. In this part of the immune system, one type of white blood cell in particular is vital: lymphocytes. There are two main types: B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes, each with different tasks. These cells have a highly specialized ability to recognize and react to molecules that are foreign to the body, antigens, which are found on microbes and elsewhere. Every single B and T lymphocyte is highly specialized to react only to one antigen with a distinctive molecular structure. Because of the large number of lymphocytes, the immune system is nevertheless capable of reacting against a large number of foreign antigens. When the individual B or T lymphocyte meets its corresponding antigen, it reacts and starts active cell division that forms an increasing number of lymphocytes to attack this particular microbe. In a great many cases, this will lead to effective combating of the infection and the neutralizing and elimination of the invading microbe. How do the B and T lymphocytes neutralize infections so effectively? The essential weapon of the B lymphocytes is their ability to produce antibodies, the important type of molecule known as immunoglobulins, formerly often called gamma globulins. When the B lymphocyte has reacted against an antigen, it is converted into a plasma cell that specializes in the production of immunoglobulins. This is a specially constructed protein molecule that has the ability to bind itself to precisely the same antigen on the microbe that the mother B lymphocyte recognizes. The role of the antibodies in the combating of infection is partly to deactivate and damage the microbe after binding itself to it, and partly to react with and neutralize any possible dangerous substances, toxins, which are released by the microbe and are important for the development of infection and disease. The T lymphocytes have different, more varied tasks in combating infection. This is a larger family of cells with various subgroups that have different functions. The most important of these are the so-called CD4 T lymphocytes. These can be said to be the most central cell type of our entire immune system. They coordinate the various parts of the immune defense in fighting against the microbial invasion and can be compared to the conductor of a symphony orchestra, where the members of the orchestra are the various types of cell and the signal molecules, which in harmonious interaction can effectively fight the infection. Among other things, the CD4 T lymphocytes stimulate the B lymphocytes to increase their production of antibodies. The rest of the T cell types have other functions, including the ability to actually kill virus-infected cells. Yet other T lymphocytes can slow down immune responses that get too strong and can be harmful. Such regulating mechanisms are important to prevent an immune response from overkilling and causing damage. An essential characteristic of the B and T lymphocytes in the immune system is their capacity for immunological memory. After these cells have encountered microbial antigens just once, for example in an earlier infection, the memory of this is stored in special memory cells that are retained in the body for years, sometimes for the rest of the person's life. If the immune system is once more exposed to the same microbe, the memory cells have the ability to react quickly and ensure a much swifter immune response than during the first contact with the microbe. In a great many cases, this will completely prevent reinfection, or possibly ensure that the infection is much weaker than the first time. It is this immunological memory that we can thank for having many infectious diseases only once. We have become immune to the microbe involved. Measles and chickenpox are examples of this. The memory of the immune system is the key to an understanding of the principle underlying vaccination against infectious diseases. Why does infection lead to disease? Certain pre-modern cultures believed that serious infectious diseases were caused by the influence of supernatural beings and evil demons. The fact that we know since the bacteriological revolution that microbes play a central role as a cause of disease naturally does not mean that we ascribe to microbes any wish to harm the human organism. Microbes invade our body and possibly cause disease as a result because of just one prime aim, which matches that of all other organisms throughout the often bloody history of evolution: to acquire food, reproduce, and spread their genetic material further via descendants. This can harm the host organism, the human involved, but from the microbe's point of view, it is an unintended side effect. What exactly do we mean by infection? We normally carry a large number of microbes on our mucous membranes and skin. They are our permanent companions, do not usually harm us, and are often useful at the same time. We use the term infection when a microbe that normally is not one of these companions, our microbiota, settles either on or inside our body. This visit is often short-lived and does not create any disease problem. Only by laboratory testing can we see if the presence of the microbe has been discovered by our immune system. Sometimes a recently infected person can carry the microbe around for a while and infect others. Such bearers of infection often play an important role in the spread of infections, for example, in epidemics. Microbial weaponry. Some microbes have the characteristic of relatively often causing disease when infecting people with a normal immune system. These microbes have a strong capacity to establish themselves in our body, to seize necessary nutrients, actively reproduce and use efficient methods of leaving the body, so spreading to new victims. Compared with many other microbes that do not normally cause disease, these microbes, known as pathogens, have a formidable arsenal of attributes that cause greatly varying effects. Such harmful genetic products of the microbe are given the name virulence factors. These help the microbe during the various stages of the infection process. Certain factors ensure that the microbe latches onto the mucous membrane cells as the first stage of invasion and infection. Others, found in many bacteria, are enzymes that break down barriers in the tissues, allowing the bacteria to penetrate further into the body. It is crucial to the success of the microbe to ensure that it is not neutralized quickly by the patient's immune system. Its microbial weaponry includes a number of virulence factors that can ingeniously hamper the various components of the immune response. Let us discuss a small selection of the mechanisms that microbes have developed thanks to their impressive capacity to adapt themselves in their duel with a human opponent. Certain bacteria, pneumococci for example, which are a common cause of pneumonia, and meningococci, which cause meningitis, have an extra-thick capsule that prevents the bacteria from being swallowed by macrophages, the great eaters, in the natural immune response. Other bacteria, such as those that cause tuberculosis and leprosy, happily allow themselves to be swallowed, but have developed tricks that ensure they survive inside the macrophages and continue to infect without being killed, as more harmless bacteria would be. Many common bacteria and certain protozoa produce toxic substances, toxins, that kill the cells in the natural immune response. Some bacterial toxins play a role by helping newly produced bacteria to leave the body and thereby ensure a further spread of the microbe. We find this in a number of diarrhea-producing bacteria, where abundant thin evacuations of the bowels spread them effectively to the surroundings so that new individuals become infected. The most dramatic example here is the cholera bacterium, which causes violent diarrhea that can lead to a swift dehydration of the patient and death after only a few hours. Certain bacteria produce toxins that have a particularly harmful effect on the patient. This applies, for example, to tetanus bacteria, which with its highly poisonous toxin causes tetanus, lockjaw, by means of its effect on the patient's nervous system. This toxin leads to violent convulsions that can create life-threatening breathing difficulties by affecting the muscles used for breathing. Even more poisonous is the botulin toxin, produced by the bacterium Clostridium botulinum, which leads to widespread paralysis of the nervous system. 1 milligram of this toxin is sufficient to kill hundreds of thousands of humans. In such cases, the use value of the toxins for the microbe is somewhat unclear. Pathogenic viruses also have a considerable repertoire of mechanisms that help the microbe and cause harm in patients. Viruses always have to invade cells if they are to survive and reproduce. Various viruses have specialized in different cells and organs in the host's body. Certain viruses, for example, attack liver cells and cause hepatitis, inflammation of the liver. Others invade brain cells and cause various diseases of the brain, such as poliomyelitis. When a virus invades cells and takes control, this often leads to the death of the cell, resulting in the release of newly produced virus particles that are then able to attack new cells. Many viruses also use tricks to hamper the host's immune response. The EBV virus, which causes mononucleosis, glandular fever, produces a molecule that inhibits the production of important cytokines in the response. Other viruses weaken the response by attacking and infecting the immune cells themselves. This applies to the measles virus and, most dramatically, the HIV virus, which causes life-threatening collapse of the immune system, AIDS, by destroying the most central cell of our immune system, the CD4 T lymphocyte. A refined way of fooling the immune system is the microbe's ability to change their antigens. The molecular characteristics of the microbe that the immune system recognizes as being foreign and therefore reacts against. A dramatic example of this is the protozoan Trypanosoma brucei, which is the cause of African sleeping sickness, an extremely serious infection where the patient is subject to brain disease that includes sleep disturbances. During the infection, which always lasts a long time, this microbe alters its surface coat as soon as the immune system has started to react against the coat antigens in order to combine the microbe. The immune system then has to start all over again and build up a new, powerful immune response against the new antigens. This happens time after time, so that the immune defense system never manages to combat the microbes effectively. In this way, infection is maintained. This can really be called trimming one's sails to every wind. The ability to alter antigens is also seen in a number of viruses, such as HIV and influenza, where it greatly contributes to the problems encountered. In the case of influenza, this means having to have a new vaccine every year, since the virus has changed its antigens from the previous season. The immune system as a cause of disease. Part of the explanation of why patients with infections fall ill is not actually the microbe itself, but the patient's reaction to it. This can be in the form of inflammation or as so-called autoimmune reactions. The combined effect of the virulence factors and the propagation of the microbes in the tissues releases, via the natural immune response, the phenomena everyone recognizes as inflammation when seen in the skin and mucous membranes: redness, heat, swelling, pain. Inflammation is the body's basic reaction to every form of injury, even if triggered by a microbe. It is useful in infection because it facilitates the afflux of the cells and molecules of the immune system in the local battle against the microbial invasion. Unfortunately, the inflammation in itself will, in many instances, aggravate the disease when it involves important organs and tissues in the body, for example, in the brain, heart, and liver. The acquired immune response, which makes its attack if the natural response does not succeed in effectively combating the microbe, can also contribute to the problems caused by the disease through the inflammation mechanisms. In certain infections, a considerable part of the disease is actually caused by the attempts of the B and T lymphocytes to clear up after the attack. An example of this is chronic inflammation of the kidneys, which can be the result of immunoglobulin antibodies reacting against microbe antigens and forming so-called immune complexes that circulate in the blood and damage the kidneys. This occurs, for example, in malaria and after throat diseases involving streptococcus bacteria. In the case of chronic hepatitis B, such immune complexes in the blood can occasionally cause extensive, life-threatening damage to the walls of the blood vessels in important organs such as the kidneys. Similarly, a type of T lymphocyte, killer cell, which act by killing virus-infected host cells, can cause serious illness when too many such cells are killed in important organs. Those infected by the hepatitis B virus are an example of this. Virus-carrying liver cells are killed by T lymphocytes that react against the virus antigens. Finally, some parts of the pathological picture in infections are a result of the fact that certain microbes can cause what is called an autoimmune disease. The cells of the immune system are normally able to distinguish clearly between the body's own antigen molecules and foreign ones, first and foremost the microbe antigens. This is vital for the proper functioning of the immune system. Sometimes, however, the immune system is no longer able to make this clear distinction. In that case, the B and T lymphocytes start attacking their own cells, and this gives rise to autoimmune reactions. This can result in serious disease via the mechanism we have just discussed, including T lymphocytes and harmful immune complexes. There are several possible causes of autoimmune reactions and disease as a consequence of infection. One happens in infections where the microbe, in nature's unpredictable way, carries molecules that are extremely like antigens on some of the patient's own cells, making it difficult for the immune cells to distinguish between them. Inflammation of the heart valves, which can be observed in rheumatic fever, a possible complication when infected by certain streptococcus bacteria, is an example of this. There is also evidence to suggest that the EBV virus that causes mononucleosis can trigger serious rheumatic diseases via autoimmune reactions. There is enormous variation in the pathological pictures caused by different microbes, and in no way do we have complete knowledge of all the important disease mechanisms possible. For the sake of completeness, we cannot refrain from mentioning that certain viruses can actually cause cancer. Once again, the mononucleosis virus, the EBV virus, which can trigger various types of lymphoma, is the first example of this to have been discovered. Other examples are the hepatitis B virus, which can cause liver cancer, and the HPV virus, which can cause various kinds of cancer, including cervical cancer and cancer of the oral cavity. The bacterium Helicobacter pylori, which usually causes stomach ulcers, can also trigger stomach cancer. And chronic infections with certain parasitic worms can also cause cancers. The fragile balance of power between man and microbe. Microbes have 1,000 ingenious methods of surviving in our body and overcoming the resistance of our well-developed, efficient immune system. There are several possible results of an acute infection. It can completely gain the upper hand and lead to the patient's death, but much more often the infection is effectively neutralized by the immune system and the patient recovers completely. In certain cases, the infection is dealt with relatively effectively but not completely, so the microbe still manages by various ways to stay in the body. In such cases, the microbe can be encapsulated without causing any further damage, as we often see with tuberculosis. With viral infections such as chickenpox and herpes, the virus, after the acute illness, enters an inactive and symptom-free phase, but does not disappear from the body. Later in life, these dormant viruses can wake up and cause new signs of disease. Alternatively, a microbe that remains in the body after the acute phase of an infection can quietly be active and cause chronic damage, until finally the disease becomes overt once more, possibly resulting in death. A dramatic example of this is untreated patients with an HIV infection. In most cases, this ends with AIDS, which is fatal. Which result is actually in the microbe's own interest? Or, to put it another way, which result is desirable from the microbe's point of view according to the laws of evolution? A pathogenic microbe that is well adapted from an evolutionary point of view has one aim: to reproduce and pass on its genetic material via descendants as effectively as possible. Obviously, it is not in the microbe's interest to cause such a violent acute infection that the patient dies rapidly. This will drastically reduce the possibility of the microbe being spread by the patient, infecting others. Nor is it always in the microbe's interest for the patient to fall so ill as to be bedridden and immobile. This depends on the infection mechanism of the disease in question. Effective droplet infection via the air passages and the transmission of sexual diseases are dependent on the patient being able to move around and infect others, so a well-adapted microbe does not want to cause symptoms of disease that are too serious. Conversely, this will not play so important a role in diseases that are transmitted via biting insects, such as malaria, or infections where large quantities of microbes are released by violent diarrhea, as with cholera. Here, the spreading of the microbes can often be extremely effective even when the patient is passive, possibly bedridden. Moreover, the tendency of certain microbes to cause chronic infections that are often symptom-free for years on end can, from an evolutionary point of view, be useful in cases where further infection is not spread as effectively as via air passage infections and diarrhea diseases. This applies, for example, to infections with the hepatitis B and C viruses, while the hepatitis A virus, which infects much more easily via feces, never causes chronic infection. But does this mode of thought fit with what we can observe in extremely serious infectious diseases such as rabies, where mortality is very high even when treated? Yes, such infections fit this evolutionary way of thinking. When these microbes infect a human, it is not an essential part of their lifestyle, more a chance affair. The rabies virus normally infects a number of wild animal species where the microbe is well adapted without causing disease problems that are too serious. That the infection is fatal in humans is thus irrelevant for the survival of the microbe and its dissemination in nature. It is in the interest of a microbe for there to be a certain balance of strength between patient and microbe, a sort of parallel to the balance of power during the Cold War. The disturbing thing about this was that the balance of power was extremely fragile, and the same applies to the balance between humans and pathogenic microbes. For it is not the case that the microbe's arsenal of virulence factors and general ability to create disease problems have been determined once and for all. It is precisely the tremendous adaptability of the microbes that has ensured their success on our planet from the beginning of time. Their ability to cause infection and disease is central to their history of evolution, their struggle to survive and spread. This means that changes to surrounding conditions will rapidly lead to change in the microbes' characteristics and their ability to cause disease. A relatively well-behaved microbe can suddenly change and become much more aggressive. Conversely, the pathogenic capacity of a microbe can decrease if it is in the microbe's interest. Formerly, it was almost an established fact that a microbe will gradually produce milder infections. Research undertaken in recent years has shown that this is not necessarily the case. Changes to a microbe's pathogenic ability can go in both directions, mainly depending on the ecological and environmental challenges to which the microbe is exposed. Many of these factors affect the characteristics of the microbes by intervening in their possibilities for infection and thereby their ability to spread and survive, which is the microbe's primary aim. Genetics and defense against infection in Homo sapiens. The cause of the vast adaptability of microbes throughout the history of evolution, which has made them formidable opponents of Homo sapiens, is the rapidity with which they can change their genetic characteristics. Bacteria reproduce by dividing. This division takes place very quickly, for example, right down to 20 seconds for staphylococci. When dividing the DNA of the bacteria, the carrier molecules of the genes can be changed by mutations. Furthermore, the bacteria can easily acquire new genes by the exchange of plasmids and bacteriophages. Many viruses also have the ability to rapidly change genetically, partly via frequent mutations, as for example the HIV virus, and partly via the exchange of parts of their genetic material with other viral variants, as we see in the influenza virus. When it comes to rapid change of the genetic material, microbes have an enormous competitive advantage compared to Homo sapiens, where an individual takes on average between 20 and 30 years to reproduce. One would then expect that we could be vastly inferior to the duel with the microbes, and that we ought to have been eradicated from the surface of the planet long since after constant pathogenic attacks for hundreds of thousands of years. That this has not happened is basically due to our sophisticated immune system. Homo sapiens has also been under the influence of the laws of evolution in the interaction with the world of microbes. Physicians of former times believed that the characteristics of the individual patient, the balance between the key body fluids, were of crucial importance for the outcome of infectious diseases. This view was held from the time of Hippocrates until the bacteriological revolution. With the new insight into the seminal role of microbes as the cause of disease, interest diminished in individual differences in the powers of resistance in the event of microbial attack. A key pioneer such as Robert Koch has posthumously been criticized for a far too one-sided focus on the role of the microbe and a correspondingly small interest in individual differences in the patient's potential for resistance. As new bacteriological methods gradually started to be used for an increasing number of infectious diseases, it became clear that the outcome of infection by one and the same microbe varied a great deal from patient to patient, as regards both mortality and the general course of the disease. Had the physicians of former times perhaps been right about something? Are there differences from one individual to the next in their susceptibility to infections? I am here ignoring the difference between immune and non-immune individuals. With the advanced methods that have been developed in recent years for genetic studies of human beings, it has become clear that in every population group there are distinct differences in the genes of each individual, which, to a greater or lesser extent, affect their susceptibility to infection by various microbes. This has probably been the case since the infancy of the human race. Studies of the total genetic material of the single individual, the genome, have also shown that the duel between man and microbes during the past hundreds and thousands of years has left distinct traces in our genes. Infectious diseases that throughout history have followed an extremely serious course, with high mortality, or chronic illnesses that have led to increased mortality, bad health, and reduced ability to reproduce, have, via the process of natural selection, led either to an increase in the frequency of genes that provide an increased resistance, or to a loss of genes that increase susceptibility to the microbe involved. The process of evolution has weeded out genes that are unfavorable for survival and protected genes that are favorable. We are talking here of negative or positive selection of such genes. Such genetic investigations have been carried out by comparing population groups from various parts of the world. When our ancestors spread out from Africa to other continents between 60,000 and 100,000 years ago, they were exposed to new microbes that varied from region to region. This has influenced human beings' genetic equipment in different ways in various climes. If occurrences of genes are compared today with what we know about the frequency of the individual important infectious diseases in the same geographical area, the results are interesting. Even though much is still unclear, certain finds are worth mentioning. Most often, it is not a single gene among the 23,000 genes a human has that exerts a decisive influence on an individual's powers of resistance to a microbe. In most instances, it is a series of genes that together influence the results of an infection, even though single genes can have a greater influence than the others. This is probably the case with tuberculosis, where the accumulation of disease in certain families has been known for a long time. Before the microbial cause of this infection was discovered by Robert Koch, many people believed that tuberculosis was hereditary. Studies in Bangladesh, where cholera is a considerable threat, have shown that certain genes apparently have a protective effect against this life-threatening infection, and that their occurrence in the population has therefore increased. At the same time, the population has the world's lowest occurrence of blood group O, which is connected to an increased susceptibility to cholera. There are also some examples of single genes that offer considerable protection against particular microbes. An example from Africa and Asia is a gene that encodes for a special blood type in the so-called Duffy system. A mutation variant of this gene is strikingly frequent in West and Central Africa compared with other parts of the continent. In the same regions, the special malaria parasite Plasmodium vivax is lacking, a parasite that is the most widespread malaria type in other regions of Africa. So it is natural to assume that individuals with this gene have had a competitive advantage in the population. And we know the explanation. The normal molecule variant of the blood type in question on the surface of the red blood cells is necessary for the malaria parasites, the plasmodia, to be able to penetrate the cell, whereas the mutated form does not work in the same way. Since so many in the population bear this gene, Plasmodium vivax malaria is rare in these regions. As a new example of the arms race between the microbe and humans, it must be added that new variants of Plasmodium vivax have emerged that can also infect individuals with this gene mutation. And in the case of a formerly feared disease such as leprosy, there are finds indicating that single genes have a protective effect. Such a gene is present in no less than 70% of the European population, where leprosy has been virtually eradicated over the past centuries. The occurrence of this gene is only 2% in China and 9% in India, where leprosy is still a considerable health problem. Let us discuss the HIV virus, which, until the events of 2020, has given rise to the largest pandemic, a worldwide epidemic, in recent times. Here, too, we find that genetics influences the susceptibility to infection. The clearest example is the CCR5 Delta 32 gene, a mutation variant of a gene that controls the production of a molecule on the surface of the CD4-positive T lymphocyte. The normal variant of this gene is necessary for the HIV virus to be able to penetrate into the cell and cause infection. An individual who has a double.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.